I'm really pleased to be here and tell you a little bit about what we're doing with a technology that we're really excited about. But before I do that, let me describe an enormous world problem. World population today generates about 1.3 to 1.5 billion tons of MSW annually, and an equal volume or amount of industrial waste. That waste represents a volume of 1 mile by 1 mile by extending 4 miles into the sky. So it's a gigantic problem. If you take the MSW fraction alone, the energy value in that MSW is equal to about 4 to 5 billion barrels of oil. That's about two-thirds the oil that the United States uses annually, and about 13 to 15% of what the world uses. And as the world populations continue to grow and become more economically developed, this is only going to become a larger problem. Most of this waste is disposed of in landfills, and so it results in huge quantities of greenhouse gas emissions as well. So we have come up with a solution we think that is really good. So imagine if you could take what Will just talked about and put a box on a landfill and bring that MSW into the front end of the landfill, or in front end of this box, and get clean renewable energy out the back end. Well, that's actually doable today. This is a photograph of a plant that is sitting on one of Waste Management's landfills in Oregon. And it can process about 25 tons of MSW daily and convert that MSW into clean renewable energy forms. Even though it's a pilot for MSW at this location, it's actually economically viable today for higher value waste, so hazardous waste, industrial waste, things like that. Plants like this are very economically viable and have very high returns on investment. But this is just the beginning. We really believe that taking a technology like this can solve the larger MSW problems and industrial solid waste problems. So what type of plasma do we use? We use what's termed atmospheric pressure plasma, or a plasma that operates near atmospheric conditions, where we impose a voltage, a fairly high voltage across this plasma, and run the plasma at or about the temperature of the surface of the sun. At those temperatures, any waste that comes close to that plasma is broken down into its elements and smaller molecules, reforms into a clean synthesis gas. That synthesis gas then is used as the building blocks for chemicals, clean fuels, or it can be used as an actual fuel itself, a very clean fuel. Back in the mid-90s, my colleagues and I were working at the Plasma Fusion Center at MIT, and we were thinking about how we could use this type of technology as an alternative to incineration. And we came up with a very new concept that really revolutionizes the use of plasma. You've probably heard that plasma is relatively costly and energy intensive, but the plasma device that we came up with is much more energy efficient. This is what we call our plasma enhanced melter. And the way that the plasma enhanced melter works is we have a molten bed of glass in the bottom of this reaction chamber. We pass alternating current through this and resistively heat this molten bed of glass. We use that to basically stabilize or introduce the energy required just to make up the thermal losses of this system. And then we generate a plasma with a series of electrodes on top of that molten bed of glass with direct current. And we put these two systems together in a very synergistic way. We're able to tune exactly where that plasma energy goes, meaning that that plasma energy is used just to convert the carbonaceous material of the waste into the synthesis gas. And we don't waste that higher temperature plasma energy to heat the rest of the chamber. Rather, we use the resistive heating of the glass bath to do that. We further optimize the system by putting a pre-gasification step in. So anything that is very easy to gasify, we pre-gasify it, and the more recalcitrant materials drop into this plasma chamber and get hit with the plasma and are converted into this clean hydrogen-rich synthesis gas. Now, when you put MSW into this process. The carbonaceous material is converted into the syngas. Anything that would otherwise be converted into ash in an incineration process is converted into a glass-like material. And that glass-like material is, I have a little coupon of it here, can be used as a construction material. So this process comes as near 100% recycle as possible. If you put metals into the process, you also would be able to recover recyclable metals. So on a real high level mass and energy balance, what are we looking at? Municipal solid waste contains, on an energy basis, about 4.5 megawatt hours, kind of on an average, of fuel value or energy in that municipal solid waste. If we add about 0.5 megawatt to 0.75 megawatt of power in this plasma process, we then convert that carbonaceous material into the syngas. Now, because we're operating at fairly high temperatures, we actually do have some fairly large thermal losses, and that's one of the issues that we do need to solve. But the resulting syngas then, after that 1 megawatt of thermal loss, is still at about the input energy value, or about 4 megawatt hours of energy. And if we can convert that clean synthesis gas into electric power using standard internal combustion engines or fuel cells, generating anywhere from 1 to, if we're using fuel cells, maybe up as high as 3 megawatt hours per ton. We can convert that synthesis gas into a range of fuels, hydrogen, ethanol, methanol, gasoline, and synthetic crude. The gasoline and synthetic crude are probably only economically viable at scale. But the amount of hydrogen produced from a system that is only processing 25 tons per day is enough hydrogen to fuel 2,500 hydrogen vehicles daily, assuming an average of 35 miles per day per vehicle. The other thing to note here is MSW represents a fairly large volume. You can see it about 180 cubic feet per ton for a ton of MSW. And when we run it through this process, we end up with only 2 cubic feet of this glass-like material. So a huge volume reduction for that waste material. So the moonshot here is thinking about an entirely new waste management infrastructure where we actually take very small systems in a distributed network of these plasma gasification units as opposed to large regional units. So in the United States, we would need anywhere between 5,000 and 15,000 of these smaller units distributed across the country to process the MSW that we generate. Now that may seem a little counterintuitive because normally in the process industries, you scale technologies up to gain efficiency. But we believe that because of the situation around MSW and other waste materials, the fact that we generate it all over the country, and for other reasons which I'll describe in a moment, that we can actually achieve the same efficiencies that you could with the larger regional units. So first, MSW, as I just said, is generated all over the country. In fact, the US EPA has estimated that about 33 billion ton miles are expended moving MSW from the point of generation to ultimately landfills in most cases. That means that every ton of MSW in this country is moved about 130 miles on average. I mean, that's a huge energy resource that we utilize in just dealing with this waste, not to mention the fact that it has a lot of energy value in the first place internally. So if we use this new concept where we fully automate the plants, and we've heard in the last day that there's been great advancements in robotics. If the Google car can navigate our roads in this country, we certainly can come up with new automated systems that maybe run front-end loaders and handle the waste material coming in the front end of these facilities so that we can completely automate the facility where maybe 20 to 50 of these facilities are actually controlled from a regional control center. And what that does is that really reduces the overall labor that is required to run one of these facilities. And labor represents about 30 to 35% of the cost of one of these facilities. Likewise, If we are making many of these systems, we can standardize the units, modularize them, then these units can be mass produced. And we estimate that we can experience another 50% savings in cost if we were to do something like that. So now we're getting the cost down to the point where we're starting to compete with the larger regional facilities on a cost basis. But there are certain things that deploying systems like this on a distributed network basis allows you to do that you can't do on the larger facilities. For example, if you had a distributed generation system where you were producing power on a smaller scale, say 25 to 50 tons of MSW per day coming in, you're going to generate about 1 to 4 megawatts of power. And that's the ideal scale to put behind the meter. So rather than generating your revenue on a wholesale basis from the sale of electricity, now you're generating revenue on a retail basis. So that further enhances the overall economics of a system like this. And hydrogen doesn't travel very well. Hydrogen is a very light gas. You can deploy these units where hydrogen is used at industrial sites. There's a lot of users of hydrogen across the country. But imagine if we had these systems up and down the I-5 here in California. That would truly enable the hydrogen highway concept. Alternative fuels. Everybody's been talking about alternative fuels and renewable fuels. And certainly, this process can produce an ultra-clean syngas that can be converted into ethanol, methanol, other alternative fuels. As fuel cells become more and more available, solid oxide fuel cells, for example, at the Google campus, there's a solid oxide fuel cell. That fuel cell is actually being fed a syngas, although the input is methane right now, or natural gas. That same type of fuel could be used to power the solid oxide fuel cell directly from MSW. And some really interesting things are stabilizing the grid and integrating these systems into a smart grid network where you can act as a sink or a source for the smart grid. The other very interesting idea that actually does work is using this as an energy storage device. So for every megawatt hour that you put in to the front end of the system, you can convert MSW into about 6 to 7 megawatt hours of fuel in that ultra-clean syngas. And then if you take that 6 to 7 megawatt hours of clean fuel and convert it back into electric power at, say, fuel cell efficiency of 60%, you're upwards of 4 megawatt hours of energy that you're putting back onto the grid. So it will act, or it can act, as a very good battery. Now, to do this in this country is going to probably require about $200 billion, but that $200 billion of cost will result in $60 to $70 billion of revenue annually if we were to process all of the MSW in the country. So, interesting ideas. How small could we actually go? When we were developing this at the Fusion Center at MIT, we asked ourselves the question, could you really make maybe a plasma garbage disposal? And the answer is, technically, yes. But we're a little ways away from that. And we believe that maybe in 20 to 30 years, we actually will have little plasma garbage disposals where you just put your waste into these devices and it produces power for your home, you utilize the waste heat, or you could produce hydrogen for your hydrogen vehicle. So we really think that this type of technology can revolutionize the way that we look at waste in this country and around the globe, and believe that this will make a huge difference in society, converting waste into clean, renewable energy. And we really look forward to the challenge of making this happen. Thank you.